Morning, guys. I got to work a lot faster than I usually do. Wasn't able to do the drive recording. So I'm sitting here in the parking lot, sprinkling rain, but still wanted to get together with you guys. So when I get inside the shop here, I can start uploading. So Jesus was in the wilderness for like 40 days, camping out. Hadn't had anything to eat. No contact with any other people, and the enemy arrives. He decides to step into the situation and see if perhaps he can keep Jesus from going down this path that he just began with his baptism. So he pitches to him the first temptation. Hey, you know what? You're hungry. You've been out here for over a month without anything to eat. You're the Son of God, right? That's the case. It'd be no problem for you to turn these stones that are laying all over the ground here. You can turn any of these into bread. Have something to eat. So Jesus responds and he uses scripture. And he says pretty much, man cannot survive only on food. There's got to be something more. And that something more is indeed the Word of God. So Satan decides to move on to another area to try and tempt him. And so he takes him up on top of the temple and tells him, go ahead and step off. Because the Bible says that God will give his angels charge over you to keep you from hitting the ground, even so much as bruising your heel. Now, there are a couple of interesting things there. I think one, his talking about bruising your foot, dashing your foot against a stone, is a poke in the eye at the prophecy that God had given Adam and Eve concerning the Messiah. When God said that there'd be enmity between the woman's seed and the enemy's seed, and that the enemy, the serpent, would have his head crushed, but the Messiah would merely receive a wound to his foot. Second thing, according to tradition, Jewish tradition at that particular point in time, when the Messiah came, he would come to the temple grounds and he would descend from the roof of the temple. So it was almost like Satan was trying to, hey, you can prove you're the Messiah by coming down from the roof of the temple to meet the traditional view of the people, not what scripture said, but tradition. Tradition can be a very dangerous thing, you guys. So Jesus rebukes him again and says, you know, thou shalt not tempt the Lord your God. So then Satan takes him off somewhere and he shows him the kingdoms of the world in a flash. He sees thrones. He sees mansions. He sees wealth. He sees power. And he tells Jesus, look, I can give you all this. All you got to do is just bow down and worship me. Now, what was translated to the English word worship is a Greek term that was used for dog trainers. And it was a word that meant that when the dog was in perfect submission, all the master had to do was hold his hand out and the dog would come over and lick it to show his submission to the master. And that's what Satan was saying. Just kiss my hand. And you can have all this. Basically trying to deter Jesus from going down the path that lay ahead. Look, this is easy. You and I both know, Jesus, what lies ahead for you. You and I both know that there's pain and suffering and rejection and hate. Spit and nails. Spears. Crosses. You don't have to do all that to get this world. I can give you this world. So Jesus rebukes him again and says, get thee behind me, Satan. Now, Satan dogged Jesus' steps the rest of his life, even though he had just a few short years left before he's crucified. He dogged his steps. In fact, the Bible says that at that point, when Satan left Jesus, that he left him but for a season and sought for a better opportunity as the time came to be able to come back. Satan does the same thing with us, you guys. And it's interesting to note that the Apostle John, in one of his letters, makes this statement concerning sin, and that is, all sin is the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. And if you look at those three temptations that Jesus experienced, each one of those falls under one of those categories. It's not a coincidence. And it's not a coincidence that that being the case, the writer of Hebrews made this statement, that Jesus was tempted in all points as we have, yet without sin. Jesus continued to be tempted. Jesus continued to win and overcome. And he gives us that power by living in us. But we got to let him. He's not going to force victory on us. We've got to let him. So, take that with you today. And I hope you enjoyed it. I love going over this stuff. I love the Gospels. I love those stories about Jesus. They're my favorite, and they happen to be my strongest point in Scripture as a teacher. So, let's pray. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for all your many blessings. Thank you for a way of escape. Thank you for showing us what Jesus experienced so that we can have hope when those things come our way. And he made it through using your word and trusting you. And Father, we pray that we will do the same. Be with us throughout this day. Be with our family. Be with our friends. Thank you for everything. In Jesus' name, amen. Guys, have a great day, and I'll see you tomorrow morning.